everyone. The candidates have not received the questions in advance. Hank Reed, our timekeeper, is here to make sure that each candidate has exactly the same time to present his case. Using colored cards, he will alert the candidate to elapsed time, green at the start of a question, yellow 20 seconds remaining, and red stop. Each candidate will be given 1 minute to introduce themselves and their candidacy. Each candidate will be given time for a 1 minute closing statement relating to the evening's questions. This is not an invitation for campaign slogans, but a time to thoroughly present your views on the questions asked by your constituents. And please do not interrupt or talk over each other. Each of you drew a card for the order in which you will speak. And thank you, gentlemen, for participating. It's now my pleasure to introduce our moderator tonight. Wanda S. Lloyd is a retired newspaper editor, author, and podcaster. Her memoir, Coming Full Circle, From Jim Crow to Journalism, was published in 2020. I've read it, it's a great book. The book is a self-reflective exploration of the author's life growing up in the Deep South and becoming an award-winning and celebrated newspaper editor. In her journalism career, she spent more than 40 years as an editor at 7 daily newspapers, including the Washington Post and USA Today. She retired in 2013 after serving 9 years as executive editor at the Montgomery Advertiser in Alabama, and then returned to Savannah, her hometown, to accept the position as associate professor and chair of the Department of Journalism and Mass Communications at Savannah State University. Ms. Lloyd was inducted into the National Association of Black Journalists Hall of Fame in 2019, and in 2016, Spelman College, her alma mater, awarded her an honorary degree of Humane Letters. In Savannah, she's a member of the Savannah Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, and she's a member of the Savannah Chapter of the Lynx, Incorporated. It is with great confidence that I turn the program over to Ms. Lloyd.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much for the opportunity to be here this evening. Get my notes here. Good evening. It's such a pleasure to be with you here. Thank you to the League of Women Voters of Coastal Georgia for inviting me to participate, and for all of you in the audience who are here and those of you watching it online. To repeat a few of the rules, questions have been submitted by members of the public and have been grouped in topics that the candidates will be asked to address. These include their qualifications for the position, how they interpret the job as a Georgia senator, and how they will serve the diverse constituents in their district and the major issues they are confronting. I have selected questions randomly, and each candidate will have 1 minute to answer each question. A random drawing determined that Mr. Mallow will take the first question. The timekeeper, as indicated, will indicate the start of the answer with a green card, the 20 seconds remaining with a yellow card, and stop with a red card. We ask you to follow the warnings before you. So Mr. Mallow, we will begin with you. We will begin in a moment with some general questions, but first I'd like to ask each of you to respond to this question. Why do you believe you are the best qualified candidate to represent Senate District 2?
Nope. Awesome. Yes. Well, I currently serve as state representative for Georgia House District 163. I'm the only candidate with legislative experience in this race. And so my experience serving in the state legislature for the past 2 years have given me the experience needed to represent my current House district as well as the future Senate district in the Georgia General Assembly, in which I currently serve. My experience also being a nonprofit and a nonprofit administrator for the last 15 years, I hold a graduate degree from Savannah State University, a master's in public administration, a graduate certificate in nonprofit organizations and leadership have served me well. The University by the Sea has prepared me for this moment and this time to serve my constituency at a time such as this. I hope to continue to go to Atlanta to be an advocate for Senate District 2. As I've represented my House district well, I hope to represent the Senate district well in the Georgia General Assembly as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Mr. Young, same question. Why do you believe you are the best qualified candidate to represent Senate District 2?
First and foremost, good evening, everyone. I'm Clinton Young. I am uniquely qualified for this position. My experience as a veteran, business owner, a constituent in this senatorial district that I have experienced nothing. We got a crime problem. We get nothing. Inflation is on the rise. Our district is suffering. They're shooting women and children in my neighborhood. That's a bad thing. And as this economy continues to tank under the current Build Back Better regime, we're going to see some hard times. As I said, we got a food shortage coming up. We got inflation with gas going up. We done hit into the Strategic Petroleum Reserve. We're in trouble. They say necessity is the mother of invention, but some homemade crime is too.
Thank you both, thank you. So we'll start with some general questions. District 2 is a very diverse area, very diversified constituency. It includes the cities of Bloomingdale, Garden City, Pooler, Port Wentworth, and Savannah, and the towns of Thunderbolt and Vernonburg, as well as the unincorporated Georgetown. Mr. Young, we'll start with you. How do you intend to balance the varying needs of the voters you will represent?
As I stated, first and foremost, we will work hard to take care of safety of our constituents. My 2023 setback includes 40% for safety, 20% for education, and 40% for transportation. As we decided to not drill for all, mass transportation will become a great necessity. And my intentions is to put 5 cents on all print lottery tickets. Last year the lottery did $1,544,000,000 plus, and that's with only 6 months of that extra play day. By putting a nickel with that, we can fund our police departments, where they say let's defund the police. We're gonna fund the police. We're gonna get teachers a 10% raise. Active duty teachers 5% for the retirement fund, and 5% that remained in 5% for cafeteria, bus work, bus drivers, as well as custodial, and 40% for the transportation. That's how we'll remedy that problem.
Great. Mr. Mallow, again, understanding the diverse constituency in District 2, how do you intend to balance those varying needs of the voters you will represent?
By representing them in the Georgia General Assembly. My opponent has talked about this set act, which will add a 5-cent tax to the lottery, which will be a tax on poor people that play the lottery, number one, who don't receive their fair share in education because we don't have needs-based scholarships in the state of Georgia. The lottery has a reserve that has over $50 billion in it currently. I don't think we need to add any new taxes on that. We've been in a Republican-controlled legislature since I've been serving with the Republican governor, Republican Speaker of the House, and Republican Senate, and the state of Georgia has not done anything to address violent crime in the state of Georgia under Republican leadership. And so my plan for the district is simple. We're going to address needs-based aid. We're going to work to make sure transportation is available. We passed HB 511 last session, which is the Transportation Trust Fund, which has about $22 million, and none of that money has made its way outside of Atlanta. So we don't need a new tax. We just need to get the money that has already been appropriated in this trust fund to come to municipalities and governments outside the city of Atlanta. And so my plan is simple. I'll continue to fight for public transportation to make sure we have equitable distribution of funds. We'll also work to make sure we've got needs-based aid. We'll work in this state to expand Medicaid, and we'll work to help move people out of poverty, because truly, if you want to see a different community, we have to help lift people out of poverty and give them livable wages. The state minimum wage is still $5.15, and so we need to make sure that we raise the state minimum wage to a wage that's competitive in the private sector today. So we'll continue to do all of those things in the legislature. Thank you for the question.
Thank you, Mr. Mallow. Continuing with you, Housing is an issue in District 2. How would you propose to address the severe housing problems we have in the district? What do you think they are, and how would you address it?
Absolutely. I think we need to increase funding to the Georgia Department of Community Affairs. Currently, our 4% tax credits have actually become competitive, and so now we also have the 9%. And so we need to increase funding so that we can incentivize developers to build more affordable housing, creating a pathway for them to do so. We also need to look at some of the regulation that prevents local and municipal governments from entering into long-term lease agreements for the purpose of developing affordable housing. And that will be done through a constitutional amendment at the state. We also need to look at ways that the state could get creative and how property taxes and ad valorem taxes on real estate are collected, and establish an affordable housing trust fund so that we can get serious about making housing affordable in this state. In Chatham County, we've got a 40% owner-occupied rate of housing that's owned by an individual. Many folks are facing, rents that are sky high. And the only way that we can make rent affordable, as wages are not rising to the rest of the economy, is to create more workforce and affordable housing that people can actually afford based off the salaries that they're paying today. And we can do that through some creative ways at the state, through state legislation, and I intend to be a champion for those legislative items that will be in the next legislative session. So thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Young, same question. How would you address the issues of housing in District 2?
First and foremost, you're going to see a housing crash that make 2008 look like play school. You just seen the feds go back to back to back with 3/4% interest. You're going to see a full point coming up. Folks cannot afford the high rent. Now, how do we remedy that? No, the lottery is not a tax, but we're going to put one on alcohol as well as tobacco, and we'll distribute that for housing and Medicaid expansion. Now, my opponent wants to bring in gangsterism by ways and means of legalized gambling. We don't need that. Crime accompanied that. You find prostitution, drugs, and the strong arm robbery when you bring legalized gambling in. Let's go for bringing in a original equipment manufacturer, just like we just did with Hyundai. That's my bringing more of those. That's my plan.
Thank you. Now I want to ask a question of you individually, and I'll start with Mr. Young since you just wrapped up. Mr. Young, as a Republican running in this race, having run as a Democrat in the House 165 special election in November 2021 and in the 2020 Democratic primary, what now motivates you to run as a Republican in this election?
Well, that was a nice question. I was always an outsider in the Democratic Party. I don't believe in the murder of babies, okay, and that's not health care. Homicide is homicide, on the street or in the womb. You know, God will not bless me for supporting that, just like he's not going to bless America unless we repent for that. I was always pro-family, always pro-Second Amendment, and I'm for funding the police. Just imagine calling the police when this crime gets off the chain. I'm a conservative. I'm for family values. I'm pro-America. I'm pro-Georgia. I'm pro-God.
Thank you. Mr. Mello, as a Democrat, what lessons have you learned as representative for Georgia's House District 163 that you believe will benefit the voters of Senate District 2?
Absolutely. I think that's a great question. I think the first thing that I learned is that the lotto is actually gambling that's legalized in the state of Georgia. And so my opponent wants to add a 5-cent tax to the lotto and talks about gambling, but the lottery is actually gambling. And so I think my constituents will benefit that I'm connected, I am informed, and I've represented them well in the Georgia General Assembly. I've voted no against casinos. I support sports betting to fund needs-based aid. Georgia is one of very few states that actually has need that doesn't have needs-based aid for college students to be able to make college affordable. As we look at the rising cost of student loan debt, and we know that education is a pathway to help people move from a place of poverty to a place of opportunity, we need to increase those pathways so that every child who wants to go to college has an opportunity to do so. And we know that, as my opponent stated about criminal justice and police and law enforcement, I've never said that I don't support law enforcement. Actually, I do support law enforcement. And unfortunately, funding municipal police departments and agencies is not an issue of the legislature. That is left to county and city governments to fund those police departments. That is not a state issue. And so I think my opponent may want to run for a local office if he wants to address the issues with crime and funding police officers. That is not a state issue outside of the Department of Public Safety, Georgia State Patrol, as well as Capitol Police and the GBI. Those are the state entities, and we actually have a study committee going
on
right now.
Thank you so very much. Mr. Young, we're going to move to the topic, the area of managing growth, which is very important in District 2. So much of District 2 is experiencing unprecedented growth, putting pressure on infrastructure, housing stock, and other resources to the extent that some say their quality of life is being impacted. The Port of Savannah is expanding, as you know, bringing substantial benefits not only to Savannah but to the entire state. And with this expansion comes the possibility of increased impact on emissions, road use, schools, and water supplies. What do you think can and should be done at the state level to best serve both the economic and environmental health of this community?
Well, I think the logistics are in place. You know, preparing the infrastructure for growth by, you know, water lines, the electrical, you know, the electrical outlets and everything for these communities, as well as housing. I look at the Veteran Parkway where they're making provision out there. That's ahead of time. That's advanced planning. We need to continue our advanced planning, but for also we need to prepare the workforce for these companies that's coming here. And I believe that we should implement into the public schools, you know, a program started about 35, 40 years ago, Georgia Quick Start. I think the Georgia Quick Start program should be implemented into the high school level so we can have a ready workforce for this growing that we experience here in Chatham County.
Thank you. So continuing in that same area of a diverse community, managing growth, that is, I'm sorry. Let me just get to my question here. District 2 is diverse, and with four different municipalities and competing interests, what's good for business is not always good for District 2 residents. I'm sorry, let me go back to the question I skipped over. What do you see as the greatest opportunities and challenges because of the growth that is being experienced?
The greatest opportunity, as I said, is bringing in an OEM, original equipment manufacturer. We have three in this region's portfolio. We have JCB, we have my former employer Gulfstream, and the new addition of Hyundai in all three of their divisions. Bringing in gambling would not do it, okay? It won't. And the lottery, that's a pleasure principle. You choose to play the lottery. That's not a tax.
Mr. Mello, what is the greatest opportunity and challenge because of the growth?
So the greatest opportunity will be the Hyundai plant going on the mega site. That's a great opportunity. However, the challenges are the strains to infrastructure, the strains to roadways, the houses that haven't built, and the educational system. You're going to have a lot of people moving into a community where they don't necessarily have schools built for those folks, and they don't have a taxing base to raise the revenue to build those new schools. So one of the greatest, I would say, blessings to the region would be Hyundai locating into our region and our area. And at the same time, it is going to cause a great strain and burden on other and local municipalities as we look at how do we even get folks to those jobs? How do we get people who work in the city of Savannah that don't have their own car, own transportation to the site so that they can gain meaningful employment? How do we address some of the rural Georgia issues where transportation is also an issue there? Transportation infrastructure are going to be a great key to making sure that one of our greatest challenges can become one of our greatest assets. And I think we can absolutely do that through Build Back Better with some federal matching funds to support our investment in our infrastructure, which we desperately need. The state can make more investment in our roadways. We've done a great job with the Georgia Department of Transportation, but we really need to focus on intermodal transportation to ensure that we have public transportation available and connecting communities and moving people from where they are to where the jobs are so that they can have meaningful employment. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Young, should the district senator have a working relationship with the elected leaders in each of these municipalities in District 2? How do you plan to work with the various constituencies within these municipalities?
It's supposed to most definitely have a relationship. The job that the second district senator would do is to pass bills and write bills and laws that will affect each and every one of these municipalities. I will have a close working relationship with each of the four municipalities. We will have a monthly meeting to find out their needs, but we must work together. That's how we're gonna take care of this crime problem that's on the rise, as well as the problem that we're going to have in transportation. I agree with the young man. We need mass transportation, and that's why I said we'll put 40% of the set act for mass high rail transportation. We'll build schools. We'll get teachers pay raises, competitive pay raises. Okay, go ahead. I digress.
Mr. Mallow, how about you? How would you work with the individual constituencies in these municipalities?
Well, I currently work with the City of Savannah. I work closely with the City of Savannah. This past legislative session, there was a move to dissolve the City of Port Wentworth. I went to work for Port Wentworth without representing them. And currently, I'm working with the City of Garden City on addressing the railroad crossing that stays, you know, blocked for 2 to 3 hours at a time, blocking residents in their homes. I just signed on to a letter supporting a grant opportunity to study relocating and moving the railroad crossing, maybe building a bridge so that we can alleviate the burden of the residents in Garden City right now at this point in time so that they can have a better quality of life in case of an emergency, so an ambulance or police can respond to their needs and requests so they're not blocked by a train. We all know about the train issues on President Street and Garden City, so we're going to work to see how we can alleviate that at the state level, as well as working with those private companies to see what they can do to partner with us to help do that. So I've worked with those elected officials. I'll continue to work with them to address their concerns. That will be done by a majority resolution from their city councils. And once they give me a resolution of the majority of that city council, then I will work to address their issues. If it's local legislation or statewide legislation, we'll work to address those issues once we hear from those municipalities and their constituents. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So we're going to move on to a category, violent crime and the justice system. Gun deaths are on the rise, and it's estimated that the resulting injuries cost Georgia $12 billion, of which $581 million is paid by taxpayers. Since gun violence is one of the major concerns of voters in Senate District 2, to what do you attribute the rise in gun violence, and how do you propose to address it, Mr. Mallow?
Absolutely. There's a couple key things I think that we can do to address gun violence in the state of Georgia. The first thing is to close the domestic violence loophole so that people who are given temporary restraining orders and protective orders have to surrender their firearms to the courts, because many of their most intimate partners will die by gun violence, because there's no requirement in the state for those who suffer from domestic violence to have their perpetrator surrender their firearms. And many of those women will die at the hands of their abuser. The second thing is we need to close the loophole on background checks from a private person-to-person sale as well as a gun show sale so that everyone who has a firearm in the state will go through a background check. And the other last piece will be reversing constitutional carry. Constitutional carry has done nothing more than allow criminals to carry guns, and police officers cannot stop them and ask them a question about whether they can carry this weapon concealed or not because it would violate a constitutional right in this state. We know that we can address that issue by simply having a permit to carry a concealed weapon, which we already have. The governor didn't do away with that. And so we can address that simply. And the last thing is we just need to ask gun owners to be responsible and stop leaving their firearms inside of their cars unlocked so that young people who come and pull door handles don't have easy access to such a deadly weapon by careless people leaving them in their cars unlocked. And if we do those things, we might have a better and safer community because the access to guns will not be on our streets so readily. Thank you.
Mr. Young, same
First
question.
And foremost, there's no such thing as gun violence, such thing as violent people with guns. Get that straight. Violent people with guns. Until you put some teeth into the law, you're going to have continuous lawlessness. Now, I believe in background checks, okay? Background checks, and we should also raise the age for, they call them assault weapons. There's no such thing as an assault weapon. Got some real high-powered stuff, too, though. But how about a 30-day wait period, and how about a 25-age limit? But I don't believe in unarming honest citizens. That makes no sense. You got a right to protect yourself, your wife, your children, and everything you go out and work for. We need to stiffen up on the laws of violent criminals. If a person commit a crime with a gun, how about a little double time? And I believe in retribution. I also believe in a second chance. But when you take a gun and you go out and hurt someone in a commission of a crime, you need to do some real live time.
Thank you. Mr. Young, a follow-up question on the justice system. In 15 states, including Georgia, felons are allowed to vote only if after they have completed their sentence and parole or probation. Do you agree that the current law, and if not, with the current law, and if not, would you allow felons to vote while in prison or prevent them from voting permanently?
There's no such thing as a felon voting while in prison. Do your time. Do your time. And when you get back out and display a sense of responsibility to yourself and your fellow man in your community, I believe in a second chance. Oh, your paper better be clear. I believe a second chance in society. That's what America's about. You deserve a second chance, but you're not going to be voting while you're doing your time now. That makes sense?
It's your question, sir.
Question makes sense, but that doesn't make sense. We'll be voting from behind bars.
Thank you. Mr. Mello, how about you?
Absolutely. I think your question spoke to people that were on probation and parole. And absolutely, I support people on parole and probation having the opportunity to vote. If they work a job, we'll take taxes out of their checks. So then that would be taxation without representation if they can pay taxes to the state and the federal government but can't vote in an election on who's going to represent them. By every definition, that would be taxation without representation. So people who are out on parole and pardon that are productive members of our society that are working and paying taxes should have the opportunity to participate in the democratic process. I think when people are incarcerated and they return back to society, one of the issues in recidivism is we don't treat them like people, like they're not human beings. And so they're visible people, they're real people. No, we're not talking about people voting in prison that are serving a sentence, because in the state of Georgia that is not allowed. They're actually property of the state by virtue of their incarceration. But if you're out on parole and pardon, you should absolutely, parole or probation, have the opportunity to vote. If you're going to work a job and be taxed, you should have the opportunity to participate in the democratic process, because this state will count inmates for the decennial census for reapportionment and count them as population on where representatives come from. But I think that is a disservice to count someone in the census and they're not even allowed to vote on the representative who's going to be representing them. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. We're going to move on to health care. Mr. Mallow, you'll get the first question, of course. Georgia's ranked 46th among the 50 states when multiple indicators, including access to health care, are considered. Georgia ranks 40th and 45th, respectively, in the number of primary care physicians and mental health providers. And the state continues to lose doctors and health care providers at an alarming rate. What more can state legislators do to get doctors to relocate to Georgia, and particularly to rural areas? And are you in favor of giving nurse practitioners more autonomy in underserved areas?
Absolutely. I do support giving nurse practitioners full authority to practice healthcare in rural Georgia. We know that many communities in the state of Georgia don't have access to a primary care physician or an OBGYN. So when we look at healthcare in the state of Georgia and we deal with Medicaid, we should have full Medicaid expansion to cover the most vulnerable Georgians. The people who don't have healthcare are people who step outside of the workforce to become the primary caregivers for maybe a loved one or a parent or a sister, and they have a full-time job taking care of that individual. They don't have the benefit of having long-term care insurance or some of the supplemental plans in Medicare, but they need care. And those people step outside of the workforce and are virtually a full-time employee that don't receive wages. And we have to make sure that we cover some of the most vulnerable people in our community. The Republican legislature has proposed this work requirement for 20 hours a week, but if someone's a full-time caregiver, how can they work 20 hours a week when their full-time job is caring for that loved one or that sick or dying parent? And that's important, and we have to address that. The other piece is we also have people who are bad actors in the state of Georgia who knowingly pay people under the table when employees think they're actually employees. They give them a check, not a 1099 or a W-2, but they pay them under the table. And by virtue, many of those employees think they work for an employer. And so when they go for Medicaid, they say, well, you got to have some jobs. They say, well, I do work. But we don't go after those bad actors and penalize them in this state. And we absolutely have to do better to protect the worker in this state. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Young, same question. What more can legislators, state legislators, do to get doctors to relocate to Georgia? And are you in favor of giving nurse practitioners more autonomy?
I'm in favor of giving nurse practitioners more autonomy, especially in the rural area where there's a lack of mother, infant, prenatal care. I lost my wife in a similar situation back in 2000 from the lack of prenatal care. Our state has a rate where a woman is 8 times more likely to die from the lack of prenatal care. I lost my wife in 2000 from a 96 blunder. With the doctors, you can attract more doctors in this deficient state by maybe helping them out with their student loan. That'll be an attractive draw for them. And I believe that would solve some of our problems. Funding, Medicaid expansion, you know, that's one of my priorities. As I said, you can hit the vices of alcohol and tobacco to cover that.
Continuing, Mr. Young, 1.4 million Georgians do not have health insurance, and Georgia's uninsured rate of 13.7% is the third highest in the country. Why do you think there are still so many Georgians without health care, and what is your position on Medicaid expansion?
As I stated, my position on Medicaid expansion, I will fight to expand Medicaid. You'll hear a lot of my opponent's party stating that the governor turned down a lot of money for Medicaid expansion. You know, maybe we'll revisit that. And, you know, like I said, I believe everyone should have great access to health care in the richest nation in the world.
Mr. Mallow, how about you?
Absolutely. I served in the legislature and under Republican Governor Brian Kemp and the majority part of the Republican Party of the legislature, they've actually voted against Medicaid expansion both years that I've served in the legislature. And so I do support Medicaid expansion. My opponent's party does not. And we've not expanded Medicaid in the state of Georgia to cover the most vulnerable Georgians who need health care and need health care desperately. And in order to do that, if we want to save hospitals in rural Georgia, we want to provide health care in rural Georgia, we've got to give people an opportunity and a pathway so that they can have basic health care. That basic health care will allow them to go to the dentist, that will allow them to go get preventative treatment so that people aren't dying from preventable diseases like hypertension and diabetes. I'm sure my opponent thinks everyone is dying by murder and gambling, but that is not true in alcohol. That's not true at all. People have comorbidities and cannot see a doctor. They can't afford insulin. And so it's important that we make health care affordable in this state, and we can incentivize and attract doctors and physicians by knowing that we can cover the most vulnerable people in our state to provide them with health care. We can expand Medicaid for mothers past the first 12 months, and we can cover that child. And so we have an opportunity to do that in this state, and we need to do the right thing by those folks and make health care affordable and make it available and expand Medicaid, and I'm a candidate that's going to be able to work to get it done.
Mr. Mello, continuing, we're going to talk about something that's been mentioned here just a few seconds ago, maternal mortality. At present, nearly one-fifth of women in Georgia, of reproductive age in Georgia, are not covered by public or private health insurance. It is the third highest percentage in the country. How do you propose to improve the health of new moms and babies in Georgia, especially those who reside in District 2?
Absolutely. We need to make sure that the access to prenatal care is available, and that also comes as a byproduct of Medicaid expansion. By expanding Medicaid, we will provide coverage not only to the mother and the child. We'll ensure that those families have an opportunity to have the basic of basic health care available in this state. By doing a full Medicaid expansion, we can make sure that the counties that don't have OBGYNs and prenatal care will also have prenatal care. But with our level one trauma center closing in the Atlanta area, I think we have a real travesty on our hands because we have limited hospitals and access in rural Georgia. And in order to make sure that we can reduce the amount of mother mortality, we need to get the state of Georgia out of making decisions for health care for women. We need to let women make their own healthcare decisions and make those decisions with their physicians and their doctors because they know them and they know their issues and they know what's best for them. Every time the state gets involved in making decisions for women, it does not go well. And so we know that African American women are more times likely than not to be misdiagnosed, underdiagnosed, and having access to healthcare is important because they do not have the right providers in their area to service them and provide that health care to them. So yes, abortion is health care. We need to let women make that choice of what's going to be best for them and allowing them to make that medical decision with their physician and with their doctor and not with the state of Georgia by giving full authority to make sure that if they are vulnerable that they can be covered and that they can make a decision that's best for them.
Thank you so much. Mr. Young, same question.
I believe that, as we said earlier, the empowerment of the nurse practitioner. As a little child, I remember the nurse would come around and make sure that the mother was doing well, that the children had all their shots. You know, I think we need to put on more and empower more nurse practitioners to make the house call. That would solve a lot of problems. And no, once again, abortion is not health care. How could murder be health care? One of the party's members said that you could take care of inflation by killing babies. Was that nice? That made no sense for a Harvard grad to say something like that. If we eliminate babies, delete babies, we take care 8.4% inflation.
Thank you. We're going to move on to public education. Georgia has a constitutional commitment to provide an adequate public education to all students. However, the Board of Education reports that there are 3,000 vacancies for teachers in all subject areas as teachers are leaving the profession, and there are polarizing issues facing our schools today, including school funding and imposing restrictions on books. In your opinion, what is driving that shortage of teachers? And other than raising pay for teachers, what can legislators do to support public school teachers as they work to help students? Mr. Young.
You say other than pouring money at them.
Of course, pay would be one.
We need to put some money at them for paying them well. And that's why I proposed the SET Act. 20% of that SET Act would give active duty teachers 10% every year, including what the state budget give them. In 5 years of that in place, Georgia teachers are being the top 15% of best paid teachers in the United States. You have to pay them. Now, good teachers. And the question is, too, recruiting and retention. You do that by getting the best qualified and you pay them. But I really believe that we need a better screening process of the teachers. You got a lot of teachers bringing in a lot of witchcraft, teaching it to our children, okay? I think the level of the sex education that they're wanting to push on people's children should be left with the parent.
Ms. Mello, again, what's driving the teacher shortage, and other than pay raises, what can legislators do to support teachers?
Absolutely. I think we can support teachers by supporting teachers and allowing teachers to teach history accurately and reflectively. Teachers are overburdened with cumbersome paperwork. We just passed, in the past session, I voted against the critical race theory bill and the divisive concepts bill in the legislature, because in order to teach students history, we need to teach accurate history in the state of Georgia. All we've done is encumber teachers with more paperwork, not allowing them the freedom to actually teach. And teachers are afraid that if I say the wrong thing, I'll lose my job and be sued or be jailed for actually teaching accurate history. And so when you have people afraid to do their jobs, of course you're going to have a shortage in the system. So we need to get outside of mandating and legislating what teachers do. We have a Department of Education that has standards. Those standards are put in the form of a lesson plan. Lesson plans are submitted and reviewed. That's a policy issue at your local Board of Education. When the state gets involved in what teachers are doing, instead of that local Board of Education and giving local municipalities home rule to decide those factors, I think you're going to see a slippery slope with teachers not wanting to enter the workforce. Last year I did vote to allow teachers that are retired to come back in to the system. We're bringing retired teachers back at a higher rate so that they can come back and not be penalized in their retirements to come back and teach. But I think we have to allow teachers to teach, support our educators, don't do it with lip service, but do it with our actions. Thank you.
Great, thank you. We're going to talk about natural resources. Just one question here. Georgia has no plan to curtail carbon emissions and address a global problem. A recent Georgia Tech poll found that about 60% of Georgians want state leaders to set goals to reduce the effect of climate change. Georgia's national, the port and transportation to and from the port impact Georgia's natural resources and environment. Do you support the implementation of a rail link between Savannah and Atlanta, and developing other goals for the state of Georgia? Mr. Mallow.
Absolutely. I was a co-sponsor of the study committee to authorize the Nancy Hanks, which was a passenger rail line that moved from Savannah to Atlanta. And to bring that back would allow commerce and travel on the interstate, freeing up the dependency on fossil fuels to do that. I think one of the other things that we have to do to address climate change is to address sea level rise. We as a state need to make investment in electric vehicles and electric vehicle charging stations up and down I-16. If you've traveled I-16 out of Savannah, you know that once you get past Statesboro and you hit Metter, there's a dead period. And so we need to make sure that we make the investment so that renewable and sustainable energy is available. But until we get the infrastructure in place to be able to do it so that the most vulnerable in our community have the same access and opportunity, we can't get there. And the state must make significant investments in that infrastructure so that we can get there. Being in a coastal city, we're prone for hurricanes and flooding, and we know exactly what that looks like. We need to be able to address the rising sea level that we're experiencing in our community by looking at more sustainable and more renewable energies to make sure that we can maintain our operations daily. We've got a power plant that's a nuclear plant that has gone over, and they're going to raise the rates from Georgia Power again on Georgia citizens. So we got to work to address this issue and do it immediately.
Mr. Young, same question about climate change, addressing it. And do you support implementation of a rail link between Savannah and Atlanta?
As I said, yes. And that's what 40% of the SET Act will help. We need mass transportation. The infrastructure is there. The Nancy Hank, that was before your time, mine too. And that would be an essential part of this mass transportation as we do statewide high-speed rail. Yes. Now, the implementation of the electric vehicle, that's a good thing. But we live in a real-time, high-powered gas economy. We had the decision, we're not going to drill, and look at us now. We're going with hat in hand, begging the Saudis and everybody to sell us a little bit of oil. We do need to become energy independent. We can do it in cleaner ways, yes, but let's not depend on foreign countries when we are blessed with over 300 years of resources that can make us the undisputed superpower once again.
Thank you, Mr. Young. You made me feel so old because I do remember the Nancy Hanks song. Yes, I do.
Okay.
We're gonna move on and focus on Port Wentworth specifically. Port Wentworth, as we know, is an integral part of your district, and its proximity to the Port of Savannah has been a pain and a gain for the area. However, the lingering split between the Port Wentworth and the residential New North Port Wentworth boiled over last year into a request to vacate the city's charter. Mr. Young, if Port Wentworth requests your support to vacate its charter or split into two separate municipalities, will you support that move?
No, ma'am, we don't need a Jim Crow Port Wentworth. They got about $30 million. They're about $30 million in the black. Just let them pounder on that for a minute. We got $30 million. No, you're not going to take 15 here and put 15 there. We're going to come together. I would support them working out some kind of agreement to get along. That's easy stuff to do. You know, you probably got a couple of mad people, but for the overall growth of Port Wentworth and the sustainability of it, let them work it out, and we'll work there with them side by side as one plan, as a part of that plan with the four municipalities. Get them straight. We'll work to get them straight. I'm not for that separating a city.
Same question, Mr. Mello.
Absolutely not, and I worked this past session when the Republicans in our delegation actually introduced the legislation. Maybe my opponent is confused, to actually dissolve the city charter of Port Wentworth. And I worked with the local elected officials who are the new majority to represent the city of Port Wentworth. And the times are changing, and people are changing, and their interests are changing. They're voting to elect people that will represent them and represent them well, as we should have in a representative democracy. And I continue to work, as I already have, with the leadership in Port Wentworth to make sure that there is still only one Port Wentworth. Being the only senator to represent Port Wentworth, I would have a duty to ensure that if any local legislation was introduced, that I would be a no and refuse to sign on to any such act to dissolve the city. We have great local elected officials there. I've already worked with many of them. I'll continue to work with them to make sure that they can do the best by the constituents they serve. And unfortunately, some people may not be happy, but elections do have consequences. And the city of Port Wentworth elected new leadership, and they want a different representative style of democracy. And I support that community, electing their own representatives to represent them and giving them home rule and local control to decide what happens in the city of Port Wentworth.
Thank you both. Just a couple more categories and we will be done. We're going to move on to the economy and inflation. The inflation rate in Georgia was 10.9% in August versus 8.3% nationally. But in the long term, Georgia inflation rate is projected to trend downward between 6 and 4.5% in the next couple of years. So it's going to go down. Georgia's minimum hourly wage is $5.15 and $2.13 for employees who receive tips. This minimum wage has not changed since 2001. Should this change, and if so, should minimum wages be tied to inflation? Mr. Mallow.
I don't think minimum wage should be tied to inflation, but I do think the state should put forth a study committee to study what a reasonable wage will be in the state of Georgia. We know that no one can live off of $5.15. It is impossible. And so we know that being in a city like Savannah, where tourism is a backbone, many of those folks are tip employees, they're gig workers in this economy where tourism is the backbone of our industry outside of the port. And so in order to make sure that those folks have a livable wage, We need to look at raising the minimum wage in the state of Georgia. No, we absolutely should not tie it to the rate of inflation, but we have to understand the issue as it relates to inflation. Inflation deals with wages, the cost to manufacture, produce the product, and then corporate profit. I promise you, the last two indicators between wages and the cost to produce aren't there. Corporations are making skyrocketed profits on the backs of the American people coming outside of the pandemic. And so inflation is driven by corporate greed. And so until we can address the corporate greed that exists within our community and make them pay their fair share of taxes, because Georgia has a flat tax in this state, we need to work to make sure that those folks are included in our community and that they're paid a livable wage and a wage that they could actually live on. No one should have to rely on state benefits working for the state of Georgia. So we have to address with our own house and raise that minimum wage, starting with the state of Georgia first. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Young, what about the minimum wage? Should it be increased or tied to the rate of inflation?
As a small business owner in the past, I never paid anyone minimum wage. I believe in a human wage. And you said in a couple of years, we'll be down to 6%. No, we're not. We just destroyed the American dollar, brought to you by the Build Back Better regime. The U.S., since 1973, was the international standard for the U.S. as the U.S. per petrodollar. We're now going to be replaced by China. The American economy is about to sink. When inflation hits, it goes across the board. It's not so much corporate greed. It's inflationary times we're facing. And I'm going to give you an apocalyptic optical. It's going to be real, real bad. America is being destroyed by Build Back Better. Do you want more? Do you? Go that way and you'll get it. Ball back in your court.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Young. Our final category is voting rights. Georgia saw record voter turnout in the 2020 election and a historic U.S. Senate election. In March, Governor Kemp signed SB 202, a 98-page bill that supporters say ensures secure and corrupt-free elections, and critics say gives more power to the state board and, by extension, the legislature to intervene in elections. The bill reduces the availability of ballot drop boxes, limits voting hours, as additional voter ID requirements, and makes it illegal to provide food or water to voters waiting in line. Do you think this bill will adversely affect turnout for your election? Mr. Young.
Okay. Yeah. Well, let's squash that. You just had record turnout. Yesterday morning, they had 730,000 people that exceed 18 as well as 2020. Yes, we got an extra week over our neighboring states, but I had problems in the 2020 election. 8 of my precincts were down for 3 hours. Then come a thunderstorm. Yes, Brad Raffensperger extended for 3 hours, but it took 21 days to count our votes in District 165. Now you tell me something isn't wrong with that. They fixed the voting bill. I don't believe in taking water with a note of a script ballot. I want you to vote just like that. No, bring your own water. Now that may be hard, but that 2020 elections had holes in it. For me, it did, okay? It took 21 days to count, but what they did, they projected a winner anyway.
Mr. Mallow, do you think SB 202 will adversely affect turnout for your election?
SB 202 will affect the most vulnerable in our community, that are senior citizens who may have an issue related to making a photocopy of an ID, getting that ballot back, the signature verification and being on the top flap of the envelope for the electorate. Those are the issues that are surrounding SB 202 that affect some of our most vulnerable Georgian senior citizens, number one. Number two, with SB 202, we talk about providing water and food to folks who are waiting in line to vote. My opponent may be mistaken, but it was already against the law to campaign within 150 feet of a precinct or a polling location. And so that was already law in the state of Georgia, and no one was allowed to campaign within those parameters. What we're talking about is providing a human, dignified service to people standing outside in the heat in long lines because we're underfunded. The state has created an unfunded mandate, and the former president that lost, who said that the election was stolen, went and called the Secretary of State and said, can you find me some votes? So I think the issue is not with us counting the votes. I think the issue rests with your party asking for someone to find them some votes. We know that no matter where the goalpost is, I'm telling you that African Americans will show up to vote. We'll show up to vote no matter what you set the game to be. We've proven that in the Civil Rights Demonstration. We've proven that all the way up until now. So no matter the game, no matter what the legislature sets, we're going to show up and we're going to vote. And I'm confident that my district will show up and they will vote on November the 8th, and they'll vote early. They'll vote at every opportunity
given
to them.
Thank you, Mr. Mello. Thank you. Well, this concludes our forum. I want to again thank the League of Women Voters Coastal Georgia for hosting the event, and thank all of you who are attending here today and also watching us online. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Gentlemen. I just wanted to thank you for being not speaking over each other, for answering the questions that you were asked. You did a fine job, and we are appreciative for your community spirit to be here and answer our questions.
And thanks for listening to the timekeeper.
Yes, and paying attention to the timekeeper, very important. And I want to thank Rosemary Mackey and your team that did a remarkable job over the entire election season in putting together competent and good forums. Thank you so much. And now everybody, if you haven't voted already, you have lots of opportunity between now and November 8th. November 8th is election day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Saturday and Sunday too.